Hello, fellow alumni. My name is Dr. David Turner, and I'm here to tell you about an exciting new online postgraduate diploma that I will be teaching through the Centre for Lifelong Learning from September 2014. In this podcast, I will be giving you a taster of what will be studied in the course that will hopefully whet the appetite of all would-be postgraduate students. Over the 2 years of study, students will get to engage with, discuss and critique what academics have said about the rich history of Britain's railways. Ultimately, the course is designed to take any budding railway studies student beyond the vast array of enthusiast books which, while they have their place, and while many of them are very informative, generally do not consider the broad questions of how the railways fit into the nation's history and how the nation shaped railway development, management and policy. A lot will be packed into the course. The social, political, business, technological, scientific and economic history of the railways will all get a look in. What was the effect on British business of the railways? How did the railways perform financially in the period of recession after 1870? What gave rise to the railway labour movement from the 1880s? Was the government correct to nationalise the railways in 1948 and then privatise them in 1997? What were the effects of the beaching cuts of the 1960s on society, communities and trade? We will split the 2 years' work into six stimulating modules. In the first, the contents of which you will hear some of in a moment, students will assess the railway's significant impact on British society, economy and the people in the 19th century. Nonetheless, while the impact for decades has been portrayed by historians as being universally dramatic, there were many instances where life did not change, and these will also be looked at. The second module will be on the fierce debates amongst historians about what caused the British railway industry's declining profitability after 1870. Were the railways themselves to blame for this state of affairs, or can external pressures, for example government legislation, be blamed also? In the final module of the year, the topic is railway employees over the 100 years between 1840 and 1939. Their working lives, their careers and the growth of the unions will all be discussed. In the second year, the focus will mostly be on Britain's railways in the 20th century. One question that runs through this year's modules like a stick of rock is, what are Britain's railways for? So, in the fourth module, the turbulent and at some point fiery relationship between the railways and government between the 1880s and 1930s will be assessed. Next, students will analyse the rundown and almost bankrupt state of the railways after the Second World War and how this ultimately led to something that had been discussed for over a century. Nationalisation. The last module will focus on the highly contentious and emotive issue of the privatisation of British Rail in the early 1990s. Was it really as inefficient as politicians said? To comprehensively look at what every academic has said about every aspect of British railway history in the course would be impossible. But what is provided is a stimulating and informative survey of the scholarly discourse that has taken place over the centuries. For the rest of this podcast, I want to present a snapshot of what students will have to get their teeth into the first module of the course, which addresses the highly complex issue of the railway's impact on British society and its economy. It's not simply the case that the railway's construction caused all aspects of national life to be transformed beyond recognition. The Britain of 1900 did not look, feel, function, or even smell like it had done in 1825. This is an undeniable fact. But many of the changes that occurred over this period, for example, urbanisation, the development of sports spectatorship, and some technological advancements, had begun in the late 18th century. Elsewhere, things did not change for decades after the railway connections were forged. Many of the rhythms of rural life established in the 16th, 17th and 18th centuries remained unchanged until the 1880s. They existed alongside in the industrial age. What is therefore stressed in the module is that not all the changes to Britain's lives between 1825 and 1900 were a result of the new wonder technology, the railways. But I'm clearly getting ahead of myself. Let us look through a few areas where the railways had a noticeable and substantial impact on the British nation. If you were to ask anybody what was the most important changes the railways brought, one regular response would be the speed at which people travelled increased. This is an undeniable truth. A recent study by Tim Leunig has estimated that the average speed of stagecoaches on minor routes was 7.8 miles per hour in 1836. Nonetheless, the majority of people did not have the means to use stagecoaches. They walked at an average rate of between 2 and 2.5 miles per hour. The railways arrived, and this all changed. Leunig estimated that in 1865, the average speed of a train on major routes, that is, the main lines, was 22.4 miles per hour. He also considered in his calculations that the average length of time passengers would have to be waiting for a train. This reduced the average speed of train travel on major routes to 16.9 miles per hour. This was less than his previous figure, but still more than the speed of a stagecoach. But what was the purpose of this research? After all, the fact trains were faster than stagecoaches and walking are, if we are honest, well known. Leunig's ultimate goal was to measure the extent to which the increased speed at which Victorians travelled may have benefited national economic growth in 1865. No easy task. He used a social savings methodology, which to explain in detail would take considerable time. So I'll be brief and oversimplify things. Leunig attempted to determine how much time British industrialists, managers and workers saved by travelling between towns and cities faster by train as opposed to stagecoaches and walking. He considered that the time saved not travelling could be put to far more productive purposes and, by putting a value on this time by using workers' average wages, he estimated how much the saved time benefited the economy. The result? He estimated the railways of 1865 were saving the British population 487 million hours per year, which had the possible value of £15.5 million. This equated to around 2.4% of gross domestic product. As such, the railways' faster speeds did have an impact on growing the British economy. But Leunig also added to his figure what he estimated the railways saved the populace in financial terms, calculating how much money the railways kept in people's pockets through lowering the cost of travel. He considered that this total was £16.7 million and thus the social savings railways provided the nation overall, taking into account the time saving, was £32.3 million in 1865. This, he considered, was around 5% of gross domestic product. While this is an estimate, a major problem with Leunig's figure is that it is all based on a myriad of assumptions. This demonstrates that faster and cheaper means of travel the railways provided the nation, which was often criticised, delayed and of poor quality, not unlike today, did benefit the Victorian economy considerably. Economic benefits of the railway were, of course, the last consideration in the minds of many Victorians. In cities, the railways could be a highly destructive and dehumanising force, crashing as they did towards their terminuses through residential areas and across roads. Kellett was the scholar who did the most work on the impact of railways on Victorian cities. He called the railways the most important single agency in cities' transformation. This transformation was reflected in Dickens' book Dombey and Son, where he described how the London and Birmingham Railway cut its way like a knife through Camden in the mid-1830s. The first shock of a great earthquake had, just at that period, rent the whole neighbourhood to its centre. Traces of its course were visible on every side. Houses were knocked down, streets broken through and stopped, deep pits and trenches dug into the ground, enormous heaps of earth and clay thrown up, buildings that were undermined and shaking, propped up by great beams of wood. Here, a chaos of carts, overthrown and jumbled together, lay topsy-turvy at the bottom of a steep, unnatural hill, Everywhere were bridges that led nowhere, thoroughfares that were wholly impassable. In short, the yet unfinished, unopened railroad was in progress, and, from the very core of all this dire disorder, trailed smoothly away upon its mighty course of civilization and improvement. Because of the cheap price of land, the railways usually snake their ways through areas occupied by the poor and working class. Most, Dickens included, praised the clearing of the slums initially. They were filled, many thought, with crime, poverty, and insanitary conditions. In the mid-1840s, a new site was being considered in Birmingham for the station that would eventually become New Street. A benefit, apparently, of its location was that it was close to a large range of financial and civic facilities. But another point in its favour was that it would erase a collection of streets and houses that it would be advantageous for Birmingham altogether to get rid of, both physically and morally. The proclamation of observers was, therefore, that railway construction was a social good. Or was it? The lot of those dispossessed by the railways, who were forced to traipse off to new accommodation, was not usually a happy one. But first, a few numbers. H.J. Dyas estimated that 51 railway schemes between 1853 and 1885 displaced around 56,000 people, with 37,000 of these evictions occurring in the 8 years between 1859 and 1867. Kellis suggested, however, that the lowest number of people displaced by the railways between 1840 and 1910 was 120,000. Whatever the number of people uprooted by the railway, they were many. The lucky of these were those who owned houses. They may receive a small amount of compensation. For those who are merely tenants, they rarely received compensation before 1874, and Simmons argued they trudged off to settle in whatever new accommodation they could find, which was usually of poorer quality than that they had been living in, as well as being overcrowded. Henry Austin, the brother-in-law of Charles Dickens and resident engineer of the Blackwall Company, noted that while the railway cleared some fourth-rate housing in slums, the families simply moved into smaller residences that remained near where they lived. Another effect was that rents rose way above what many could afford as good housing became scarcer. Wall stated that in London in 1850, a single room rarely cost more than 2 shillings 6 pence. By 1880, it was difficult to find a room for under 3 shillings 6 pence or 4 shillings. Doubles were even more expensive. This problem did not just affect the poor, and skilled artisanal workers and craftsmen may have found themselves living in overcrowded single-room flats and were often forced to share dwellings with the criminal poor. Attempts to tighten up what little legislation there was on rehousing came to nothing. Before 1874, there was nothing obliging railway companies to provide accommodation for the occupants of the houses they destroyed. Even then, when the House of Commons instituted a standing order placing this duty on them, they ignored or evaded it. A more forceful attempt to enforce the order occurred in 1885, but once again the railways were still placed under no legal obligation to provide alternative accommodation. The only cases where they did so being where the housing societies were allowed to construct houses on railway land. Simmons argued that there does not seem to be a single recorded case in which any railway provided satisfactory new housing to residents before the destruction of the old. Only in the early 1900s did government start to take a harder line, but by that point, for many families, it was too late. The railways also dramatically affected the nature of trade, business, and industry in Britain. In one respect, this was because of their backward linkages. The iron industry benefited hugely from the railway's construction. Gourvish considered that around 25% of all the iron industry's output before 1870 was used by the railway industry. This was a huge stimulant for the iron industry's growth and development. Academics have, however, made it increasingly clear that few industries were created by the coming of the railways. For the most part, railways widened existing markets, leading to the expansion of businesses' operations. This is no more evident than the case of the brewers of Burton. The railways did not create brewing, that's for sure. However, they were very important in allowing Burton brewers to be a dominant force in the beer trade in the 19th century. In the 1820s and 30s, Burton beer could be drunk in London, Liverpool and Birmingham, although the price of a pint remained high to cover the cost of transportation. After Burton was connected to the railway network in 1839, the situation changed. Wilson argued that the arrival of the railway did three things for brewers. Firstly, the cost of transporting beer fell dramatically. In the 1830s, transporting a ton of beer, which was about 5 barrels, to London cost around £3. After the railways arrived, this reduced to 15 shillings per ton. Also, the cost of bringing to Burton those oh-so-important supplies required for brewing, casks, malts and hops, also fell. Finally, and possibly most importantly, the speed at which beer was transported also dropped. This increased the availability of Burton beer throughout the country and, because of the high quality of the product, the demand for Burton beer skyrocketed. These changes in the distribution networks and supply chains of the Burton brewers, in combination with the quality of product, created brewing powerhouses. Bass's home trade quadrupled between 1839 and 1843. This growth continued. In 1885, it produced 145,000 barrels of beer. By 1858, production had doubled. Indeed, this shifted the company's focus from its foreign trade, which had been a major source of revenue before 1839, to internal markets. On the erection of a new Bass brewery in April 1863, the Derby Mercury commented that the demand for Burton ale was never so great as at the present time, as we were informed that application has been received for many thousands of barrel ale which the brewers are unable to supply. So what can we conclude from what I have presented here? I have talked about one economic impact of the railways on Victorian Britain, one social impact, and the impact on one industry. But I have only scratched the surface. The subject of how the railways altered the fabric of the nation is far from simple and made up of hundreds, if not thousands, of parts. I cannot begin to address all these parts in my teaching of the postgraduate diploma. That would be a task no individual could undertake. Nonetheless, students on the course will investigate, study and assess those aspects of British life the railways changed to the greatest degree. I hope many of you will be intrigued by this proposition, sign up to the diploma and thus learn more about this fascinating part of British history.